Well, good morning. Welcome to this morning's live case session, number 3 of SFA Interventions. I'm Dr. Bob Burson. I'm joined by my co-moderator, Dr. Richard Heuser, and a distinguished panel. I understand that they're ready at Asan Medical Center, so I think we'll go there now. Good morning, John. I recognize you.
Hey, Bob. Good morning. How you doing? Morning, Rich.
Good morning.
Morning.
So we're here in Cath Lab 5 at Asan Medical Center. It's great to be back at Asan Medical Center. What a beautiful hospital. I'm joined here by Dr. Yu from Korea University Hospital and Dr. Lee from Asan Medical Center. Bob, you know him well from your case yesterday. And we have a much simpler case today than you had to deal with yesterday. And I'm going to ask Dr. Yu to present the case.
Okay. This case is very simple. The 79-year-old male patient was admitted for the treatment of a claudication of both legs. He had a PTA in both distal SFA 3 years ago at other hospital. And then he recurred with the stainless stenosis. So 2 years help, and now the years he underwent another stent implantation and DCB, but nowadays he complained of both leg claudication, so he underwent a CT image, which showed that moderate stenosis in right SFA and in left SFA, ABI was 0.79 and 0.58, right?
Yeah,
okay. So he has this lipidemia as a risk factor. Next slide. So in terms of the claudication was the worse in left than right. Next slide. Okay, Daichi.
So, Bobby, basically a case of in-stent restenosis on the left side. It looked like on the CT that the stent was on the left was occluded. We'll show you now the angiograms. It's basically so that it wasn't occluded, but there's a diffuse disease in the distal SFA proximal popliteal artery with subtotal occlusion. So can we show that angiogram? Are you seeing that now, Bob?
Yes, we see it well. And it looks as though the profunda is jailed. Is that correct, but patent?
Yeah, yeah, that's a good point, because we went back and did an oblique shot of that later on. So I think you can see stents from near the origin of the SFA all the way down into the P1 segment of the popliteal. There's a couple of areas of very high-grade stenosis in the distal SFA stent. And there is moderate disease in the popliteal artery beyond the stent, and we can talk about whether that needs to be treated. Next image. So then we went back and did some DSA runs after we brought in the 6 French Ansel sheath. You can see the proximal SFA stent looks fine. There's maybe about 30 to 40% stenosis in mid-SFA. Next. And then again, on the subtracted images, we can see very high-grade disease at the overlap segment and just beyond the overlap segment, and then, you know, more significant severe disease distally as well. Next. And then beyond the stent in the popliteal artery, we do see, as you'll see on this shot, some moderate stenosis. And that's just beyond the stent. We'll probably have to treat some of that. And then next run, and then we see pretty nice runoff below knee, consistent with his 0.7 ABI.
Do we have any information on what kind of stents were implanted, what we're dealing with here?
There was a 6-millimeter diameter stent distally and 7-millimeter diameter stents more proximally. Do you know, Dr. Lee, what type of stent?
It's a self-expanding stent.
Yeah, so smart control and life stent.
Okay.
So we'll show the next shot if you would, Dr. Lee. I was curious about that bifurcation as well, Bobby, and you can see on the oblique view that the stent actually stands up and just barely crosses part of the origin of the profundus. So it's probably a couple millimeters more proximal than ideal, but as is usually the case, the profunda stayed open, so that's not so much an issue.
Right. Doesn't seem to be a clinical problem.
So the issues here is how to deal with this diffuse ISR and the distal SFA, what approach to take, and I'll let you guys, the panel, discuss a little bit while we're getting set up. We crossed the SFA high-grade disease with an 014 regalia wire, Asahi regalia wire, very easily, and we're going to go in and pre-dilate, but I'm going to open things up to panel discussion here.
Okay, so panelists, Richard, George,
Rudnap.
Yeah, I think this is an interesting case. The EXCITE trial has described the fact that compared to balloon angioplasty, a laser seems to do better, but we have a myriad of devices we could use. I probably would favor using laser, but there are other devices I'd use, even though some of them are, quotes, not indicated, but I think we could do differently. It's funny, this meeting, I think last year, a group showed a series of patients that they covered the profunda, and it's always that sacrosanct thing you don't do, but actually their outcomes were pretty good. But again, I don't think it's relevant in this case, but I think I would consider laser.
Well, pin the wire.
Okay, let's just go down the panel.
So I would agree with Richard. I would prep the vessel before biologic therapy. I think we're going to have to use some sort of biologic therapy, whether it be drug-coated balloon or drug-eluting stent. But the question is, what type of what are you going to use to prep the vessel? I would also use laser atherectomy. The new 2.3 millimeter power laser catheter, I would prefer it. Typically has to get through a 7-French sheath, however. So since we have a 6-French in, it would be difficult. So I'd probably pull a 2.0 laser. If I didn't have a laser, then I would use some sort of scoring balloon, whether it be a cutter or angiosculpt or vascutrack, to prep the vessel.
Okay, let's continue down. We're really zeroing in on whether to debulk or not, whether to stent or use a DCB.
So 150 is just a little short.
Actually, in Korea, we don't have the any laser atherectomy and any. We just have the directional atherectomy here, but it's the I know that it didn't get approved for the instant restenosis in Korea. So it's really tough to use the directional atherectomy in instant restenosis in Korea. So as the strategy to approach the instant restenosis like this case is prevalent dilatation, special preparation, the first will be done, make a decision to go to the drug-coated balloon, usually.
Okay, so a lot of votes for drug-coated balloons rather than stents. Keep going down the panel. Any comments from that end?
Hey, Bob.
Yes.
I'm going to interrupt just to tell you that we're going to go ahead, and pre-dilate here. My thinking is that normally at home I would probably debulk with laser here and then pre-dilate and use DCB. We're going to skip the laser at this point and then just go ahead and pre-dilate. We have a 5-millimeter diameter by 150 millimeter long balloon, a Savvy balloon from Cordis, to pre-dilate with. It turns out, if you can see the roadmap overlay there, that the balloon is just a little bit short. Probably the 150 is just going to be a hair short. We'll see what it looks like when it inflates. I'm going to go up now. Diameter-wise, it's probably a pretty good diameter. We can go ahead and take a roadmap off.
It's pretty close. It looks pretty close.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. There was one randomized trial while he's doing this. There was one randomized trial. It was a single-center prospective study done in Germany looking at laser debulking for ISR prior to application of DCB that was positive in favor of the combination with the laser definitely improving the DCB outcome and long segment ISR. But it's only one study, it's only a single center prospective study, so we have to be cautious of that. But that's why you hear enthusiasm for doing debulking with a laser prior to application for DCB and ISR. Now, as a practical matter here, the laser's not commercially available for this indication, and most of the treatments for ISR are done worldwide or done as it's being done here.
Dr. Troy,
any comments about this?
The
Bible. Everyone agreed? Okay, so what size balloon is this, John? Is this a 6-millimeter, 5-millimeter?
This is a 5-millimeter diameter, Bobby, a 5-150, which turns out it was just a little bit short. And I think that's 5 is well matched to the distal stent. Let's go up there, Dr. Lee. We're going to go up just here and get the rest of that lesion. So I think the 5 is matched well to the distal stent. It's a little bit small for the proximal, so we may end up using 2 DCB, a 5 and distal, and a 6 a little bit more proximal. So we went up to about 10 atmospheres in both inflations, have a nice full balloon. The only question we'll see after we take this angiogram is whether we need to extend our DCB beyond the stent into the popliteal artery. Okay, we're down. That's 10.
You know, we're always worried about evidence, practicing evidence-based medicine, but also economically we're always struggling. It would be nice to have some scored balloons that have drug-eluting technology, and I think that's coming. But right now, I would hesitate to use the drug-eluting balloon as my, quotes, prepping balloon because of the fact that you really want to get that vessel prepped to
we'll
deliver
do an
the drug.
Here, afterwards.
Well, it's a very important point, too. With ISR, frequently there's bulky hyperplasia that can really dissect, it can migrate, it can change in appearance. And so I think it's very important to do vessel prep before you apply a DCB.
Okay, we're taking the SAVI balloon out here, Bob. Then we're going to do a run and see how it looks. And you can help me decide whether I want to extend the DCB down below the stent. So we'll just do a Cine angiogram here from here on down.
Okay.
You ready, Dr.
Okay.
Yu? Okay, so we'll go ahead and Cine.
You ready?
Okay.
It looks fairly narrow distal to the stent.
I'm thinking we need to treat down to about that branch point with our DCB.
Yeah, I would
just
agree.
A little bit beyond.
Looks like it's about 60-70% at least. I would go to the geniculate. Other panelists, would you leave it alone or extend the DCB?
Let's take a 5-150 DCB.
So I would tend to leave it alone. 5-150. I would extend a little bit further just because of the geographic mismatch. Your balloon actually extended a little further out, but I'd prefer not to have to place another stent behind the knee if I could help it.
Mm-hmm. Other panelists agree? Go ahead and treat distal. Everyone seems to be nodding in agreement. So I think you have a pretty good consensus to treat.
Take that off.
George does bring up a good point. You don't want to have to stent down there if you don't have to. I know the manufacturers say it's no problem. Well, yeah. And it is a problem when you go across the knee joint and you're past the adductor canal.
Let's do a roadmap.
So you don't want to stent if you don't have to.
Well, especially since you're dealing with a long stent column already.
Yep.
You're extending it to a very long length.
And if I would stent, I would. It's a pair, would probably be the only one I'd want to put down there. But hopefully that won't have to happen here. It's starting to look better already.
Okay. So we're going to do a DSA roadmap there just to help us line up our balloon with the inflation. Okay, ready for fluoro? Okay, somebody has wire? 10 wire, please.
We frequently observe progression of downstream disease after an intervention or surgery above knee. And, you know, it's been recognized and published many times. And the mechanism is unclear. After you accomplish revascularization, you expect better flow to yield better patency, but somehow you can see it. You can observe acceleration of downstream disease in the popliteal segment.
It may be catching up above, actually.
It seems to be a case one would expect that when they originally stented this, that area of vessel probably wasn't significantly diseased at the time.
So here's the downside of using a 014 wire, Bob. We're catching on that proximal stent. I'll sacrifice my hands for the good of the team.
Yeah, you may just have to switch to...
Yeah, let's take 035 wire. We have like a Terumo wire. 035 wire?
035?
Yeah.
They can use the U-shaped Terumo.
Or what you can do is push your wire in.
Just a regular.
Johnny, and see if it'll push your wire off the stent struts so then you can take your blender in.
What's that, George?
What I typically do is I'll push my 014 wire in further. And it'll
that's a good thought.
Yeah, wire bias.
Yeah, and push the wire off the stent struts.
Sometimes helps, but usually...
Yeah, I don't think it has enough support. We'll take... we can take the J wire if it'll go. We're just going to switch our wire real quick in the interest of time.
Yeah, or the U-shaped Terumo wire would probably go down really well.
Okay. Yeah, we hate to... hate to have that balloon sitting in there too long, you know, because ideally you want to get it down to the lesion within 3 minutes. So we're going to put a J Terumo wire down there and see if that'll go as per Bobby's recommendation.
So which DCB did you choose? What do you have?
So
there?
We picked the Impact Admiral. It's actually, can you...
Okay.
There you
go. I'm going to pan down, if you would. It's Impact Admiral, Bobby, 5 millimeter diameter by 150 length. Nice to have the longer lengths here in Korea than we have in the U.S. Pin wire, please. Mm-hmm. So we'll see if this will go now. Yeah.
And ISR lesions, it's unusual for the balloon to catch on the struts on the way down unless you have a fracture.
Test?
Okay. So we'll do a little test here and just see. Yeah, we lost our roadmap, but we'll do a little test here and see where we are relative to that branch. Okay, I want to start right there. Okay, let's go ahead and go on up. And so I'm going to give you a little time to talk here, Bob, because I like to do... 3 minute inflations with these DCB.
Sure. So, now remember that area was not predilated, so I would go up nice and slow here.
Yep, I agree. Thank you. And we're not going to go too high, probably. We'll see how it looks as it goes up.
And it's a 5 millimeter diameter.
5 millimeter diameter, 150 length, Impact Admiral. And I think we talked a little bit yesterday about. The data from the global registry showing really very good results with the Impact Admiral balloon for FEMPOP ISR.
So panelists, how do you monitor these patients? This is an ISR case who's being retreated. Do you change your follow-up strategy?
So
do
maybe
you,
image like a 680, and do we have
like a 680 more frequently?
680.
Is this somebody you would want to watch every 3 months versus every six in the first year? Do you do anything differently?
So typically what I do after the intervention, I'll get an ABI duplex so I have a baseline. And then typically
we have timer?
With these longer lesion stents, I do watch them a little bit more closely. So I'd probably bring them back at 3 months, make sure there's no change in their symptoms, check another ABI duplex,
and then just, we'll take a picture.
Maybe at 9 months, I'd push them out to 6 months, and then if they're doing well then maybe 9 months to a year every time I bring them back in, with the understanding if they get any symptoms to let me know as soon as possible.
Okay. Other comments as far as follow-up? You do anything any differently?
We don't know yet correct answer.
25 is a good size
my,
here.
Six will work perfect for my practice. I'll give you therapy for 3 or 6 months.
Talk into the microphone if you could.
Your antiprox therapy for 3 or 6 months.
6 months, okay. Also, so really no increased surveillance in particular on this? Or would you image more frequently?
I'm not very experienced for the direct balloon for, but I have some question for the how long inflation time and how much atmosphere for such a case. I sometimes thinking about Well, more high pressure is not for benefit for patient, I think. Do you think it?
Not sure. I followed that carefully here. So afterwards, do you image them at 6-month intervals, or would you image somebody like this more frequently to do surveillance of the outcome? As far as duplex ultrasonography, would you follow them more frequently or not? Do you do standard follow-up every 6 months, or would you do it more frequently in this case, every 3 months?
Is that 12 months for them?
3 months,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Perhaps more frequently. And then the other thing that comes up, you know, when it comes to diffuse ISR is, what about antiplatelet therapy? You know, we're not putting in a new stent, it's not required, but do you keep these patients on dual antiplatelet therapy?
We're down.
And if so, for how long? And are you concerned about rethrombosis or reocclusion? Because these do run a higher risk of such. Just down the panel.
Yeah, that's a great point. But in fact, I was going to say the same thing. I think it's important to have surveillance on the vessel, but it's also, let's put in the context of the patient. As a cardiologist, I really want to make sure that there's no other disease. I want to make sure I'm following their coronary disease, following their carotids, and also modifying their risk factors. And the data out there, if you don't do intervention in patients with PAD, is really good with antiplatelet agents and statins. So if we don't put a new stent in, many would say, oh, we don't have to give them antiplatelets. Well, I think that they failed, and I think it's important to consider the entire patient and the entire vasculature. So I think that's important to do.
It's a great question, too. So recently at Link, we presented EPAD, and what it was an anticoagulant, a factor 10A inhibitor, compared to standard therapy aspirin and Plavix. What's interesting is that times with these in-stent restenosis, if
can we stop it when it's full?
There's a thrombotic component to the in-stent restenosis.
Absolutely.
EPAD actually showed there was an actual benefit. There was a trend toward benefit for restenosis utilizing a factor 10A inhibitor versus aspirin and Plavix. Remember that Plavix, there's very little evidence for it. Most of us extrapolated from Capri.
Maybe 10.
And then Tomas Zeller did an 80-patient study showing the benefit of Plavix. With your standard lesion. So very little evidence to support Plavix in addition to aspirin. So I think it's wide open, and some people may consider putting them on an anticoagulant.
It's a great point, George. There's a lot of interest in NOACs as far 100. As follow-up of management of patients undergoing vascular intervention.
We'll cover that other area.
So one thing we haven't talked about here is the other strategy is to reline the ISR. With a Viabon. And when do you decide to do DCB, and when do you decide to do a Viabon? This is a long stent column, which ordinarily you would say Viabon might be a good approach. On the other hand, only part of the stented column is restenotic. So, and this is easily managed with one, maybe two DCBs. So panelists, any comments on whether to do this case with DCB or a Viabon reline ISR.
Okay, ready for...
I think it'd be good, actually good anatomy for either.
So definitely for this kind of case, I think every case need debulking devices, because if we do just balloon and put the DCB on, the tissue is always there. We just squeeze them on the wall, but they're still there. I just had a case with this kind of instant restenosis, lots of tissue in there, and I just, at that time, I didn't have any atherectomy device, and also we don't have laser device in Bangkok, so I just did balloon angioplasty. Even the higher, one size of balloon with high pressure, we still have the lots of tissue, residual tissue inside, but there was no way, so I applied the DCB, but the final result was not that good, and actually the patient just came back again within just a month. So I think the very important strategy for this kind of instant restenosis is to debulk it and follow it with a DCB.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, debulking makes sense here, huh? We just need a larger volume of evidence, I think. So, Johnny, we've had some good conversations about other strategies to manage this. How are you doing?
Good, Bobby. We're just going in now with the sixth balloon. It's getting caught a little bit up on that stent again. It's kind of annoying. I'm going to bring the sheath down a little bit. See if we can...
This is even with...
Wire.
Which wire do you have in there? Hey, it's the none. There
well,
it comes.
That's a good question. We had no wire in there. It turns out my partner's sabotaged me a little bit.
That's what makes it more fun, John.
Keeps you on your toes.
Yeah. Just wanted to see if you were watching.
That's about right where we wanted it. Let's do a little test to run.
Oh, for a 300-centimeter drug-eluting balloon. Boy.
So here we go. Originally, it was the distal half of the stented segment. We made that look very good, and now the more proximal to mid is not quite acceptable. So,
so Bob, quick question for you. So you had brought up these covered stents. So in the read line, it implied that the entire lesion should be covered. So with this case, considering it's half of the stent, more or less, or three-quarters of the stent, and our stent gels the profunda, if you were going to line this, where would you put it?
It's a great question, and that's what makes, I think, relining this with a Viabond problematic, is where do you start and where do you stop? It's been stated that if you are to apply a Viabond to reline an ISR lesion, that you should treat the entire stented segment and go proximal and distal to the stented segment to land the graft in healthy tissue. That being said, it's not really based on a lot of evidence, but it just intuitively makes sense that you would rather not land the proximal edge in an ISR segment. So in this case, I think it is particularly problematic in that the stented segment does go up to and partially cover the profunda, and that only half or maybe two-thirds of the stented segment is restenotic. So I think in this case, I agree with the approach to use a DCB. Long segment, long being 20 centimeter plus ISR, is something that I think is going to be an area of further interest to help ferret out whether long segment DCB applications or Viabonds are equal or if one strategy is superior to the other. Right now we don't know. But the teaching has been to treat the entire stented segment with if you're going to reline.
So Bob, this case actually fits nicely with the Medtronic Global Registry ISR, you know, cohort. The mean lesion length in that cohort was 17 centimeters, which is almost exactly what we're dealing with here. And I, you know, there was about 150 patients in that cohort. Didn't involve debulking, just predilation and DCB alone. And despite that, the results were really excellent, with you know, patency in the 80s at 1 year, and TLR rate less than 10%. There was a need for stenting, bailout stenting, in about 14% of those cases. I don't think we're going to need to stent here, but that's always an issue. You know, whenever you're treating long segment disease with DCB, the potential need for a bailout stent. So this is right along the lines of the registry, and if we, you know, get as good a results as they did in the registry, I think we'll be happy. I agree that debulking, at least theoretically, is attractive in these kinds of cases, but there's not a, you know, really a strong body of evidence proving that. And normally I would probably debulk with laser, but I think also it's very appropriate just to treat with predilation and DCB alone.
Okay, so where are you on your timer there? The other room, I think, is ready for us now.
Tell you what, we're going to come down here, Bob. We'll come out, and then we can get you a final angiogram, and I think then we'll be done.
Great. Let's take an angiogram, and hopefully it'll look good, like the distal segment did, and then we'll go to the other room.
So we'll take the balloon out first. So the three-minute inflations never make for a very interesting live case, but the conversation, I think, was great, and so it helped kill the time a little bit.
One more observation, Bob. It's interesting that the restenosis was on the bottom third of the stents rather than the top. Do you think it's just because of the anatomical composition on how the vessel moves, or do you think the actual stent was oversized?
Well, you have two things going on. One, you have tapering diameter here, which is one, but I think the mechanical forces are really the more, I think, more important aspect to this.
Let's do a DSA at the distal.
When you have a long column like this, the force transmission and longitudinal shortening is greatest in the lower half of the superficial femoral artery, so you probably have more mechanical action. Looks like the stented segment, the ISR segment, looks good. The distal native segment is okay, actually. Are you going to leave it or treat it some more?
Looks a little hazy there in that distal part of the stent, actually. It's right actually more in the stent than beyond. I think, Bobby, we'll go in and do a long inflation and then probably call it a day. I don't think we're going to need a stent here.
All right, we'll go to the other room and then perhaps come back to you. Let us know when you're finished. Good morning.
Hey, good morning, guys.
Hi, Mark. Bob Burson, Rich Heuser here. We have a distinguished panel with us, which includes George Adams, Dr. Chung, Dr. Lita, Dr. Inu, Dr. Kim, Park, and others.
Great. So we'll look forward to some good advice while we're working here. So at my right is Dr. Choi. He and I have been working on this case. And then farther to the right is Dr. Kim. And Mr. Jung has been supplying excellent technical support here. So we're going to get going with this case, and Dr. Choi is going to do the initial history.
Yes, good morning. Today's case is a 56-year-old male was admitted for the treatment of claudication of both leg 2 months ago. He had a previous history of stent implantation at both SFA 6 years ago. He was a chronic smoker and had a history of diabetes, hypertension, and dyslipidemia. The lower extremity revealed the total occlusion of the both previous SFA stents. So at the time, he underwent a PTA at the left side SFA ISL lesion with a drug-eluting balloon. Next. We have a plan to treat to the opposite side today. Can you show us? Yes.
Okay, so here you can see the CT, and obviously the right femoral popliteal segment is occluded, and you can see the long segment of stent on the left, as well as a shorter occluded stent on the right. One of the concerns that I had was the proximity of the stents on both sides to the iliac arteries. And so there was some concern that maybe the common femoral had been stented. I thought I might throw that open to the panel. Any thoughts about how you might access this patient?
Yeah, so it'd be nice to see it's maybe a rotational CT or some other imaging to see if they're overlapped or truly jailed. In either case, it looks like you have enough room to still go up and over to treat either one. The left looks pretty close to the inguinal ligament, though.
Okay. So we had thought that even if we were in a situation where the stents did cover the common femoral, this was a stent put in March. We thought it would probably be endothelialized to some degree. And one of our options was to simply go through the interstices of the stent, mm-hmm. cross over, and go down.
Yes, you could.
Yeah. I think the other option would be to go from the arm, which didn't seem as appealing because of the reach issues. And then another option would be to figure out some kind of right-sided access. But again, I thought having visualization from above would be advantageous. So I didn't really like that approach. So we thought we'd go from the left. And Bob, kind of following up on a conversation you and I had yesterday, we reverse the patient on the table so that we're not reaching through the x-ray field when we work Good. On the femoral popliteal. And then the staff was great to reverse the image so that we didn't have to work by standing on our head when we did the case.
So, Very good.
Next we're going to show you the first image. So if we could bring up the first image here, which you should see a hemostat on the femoral head. Let me know when you get that one.
Okay.
Okay, so do you have that image then displayed?
Yes, we see it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think what you can see here is that the CT did kind of give the appearance that the stents were more proximal than they actually are. Really, the stent is down at the distal or the lower part of the femoral head. And so by marking the center of the femoral head, I thought we probably had enough of a ramp to get in without going through the stent. So that I thought was beneficial. And so we went up with an OmniFlush, crossed over, and then took this initial shot. And you can see the occluded stent there. Any comments on the panel about an initial impression now that you see this angiogram?
Well, the nice thing is you have a nub. So I think he can get into the stent, so that's helpful.
So, you know, when I see these short segment stent occlusions, it's always nice to go back to previous angiograms to see what the native anatomy looked like before it occluded downstream from the stent. You may or may not have that, but sometimes it helps you navigate once you get through the stent occlusion. But if that's not available, then I would just approach it as any other, trying to go through the ISR occlusion and then deal with the native anatomy distal.
Okay. So we did have a CT that showed the reconstitution of the popliteal and what appeared to be anterior tibial runoff. We don't have the images from 6 years ago when the stent was placed. Then we changed the angle a little bit. I agree with Dr. Adams. I think we do have a kind of a nub there, which was quite reassuring. A flush occlusion here, I think, would be much more problematic for us. And so there was a nub. We rotated out a little bit ipsilateral, and I think you can see that pretty clearly, that we have what appears to be a good ramp. So what approach might you use at this point?
Panelists, go ahead. Usually for me, stent occlusions are not that difficult to approach. I use for the stent segment itself, just a lot of times I'll just use something like a SupraCor and a diagnostic catheter to support it to keep you from migrating out of the struts. But basically a wire and a support catheter usually is all you need to get through the stent occlusion. You can pick and choose which wire and which support catheter. But I tend to stay away from angled glide wires only because they can migrate or navigate into the struts and go through struts. So I tend to use a fairly straight tip catheter that keeps me coaxial.
Okay, so with that in mind, we decided to use an angled glide wire. So what we did is we used an angled Terumo catheter, and I definitely agree with you. We really wanted to avoid going through the interstices, but my thought was kind of buckle it from the get-go right in that little nub.
Oh, sure, and, if you loop it, that's fine too. Same principle.
So we used a Terumo catheter and a Terumo stiff angled. And let's go to the next image there, please, Dr. Choi. So then we also wanted to get an idea about where things reconstituted. And you can see down there the reconstitution point is at about 12. I think in a case like this, using the measuring tape is really beneficial, especially as we think about our end game and also trying to avoid overshooting too much with a subentimal approach. Let's go to the next image. I think the next one after that is what we want. So we started with the angled catheter. We put a 6-French Ansel sheath in from contralateral. So we have the stiff glide, an angled catheter, we got it to buckle, and then we basically hit a brick wall. So as much as we tried to push at this point, it wouldn't go any farther. Any thoughts about what you do as kind of your next strategy?
We have not talked much about different crossing catheters. One of the things that I would use if it buckles like that, a lot of times I'll use the Wildcat catheter. It has a lot of heat on it, and meaning it really can push against a restrictive lesion like this. So that's one thought. You already have the patient on their back. Worst case scenario, can't do it. This is probably an easy pedal access, but you're not to that point yet because you want to continue to go at this approach. So I might want to use some sort of crossing type catheter like a Wildcat or something like that.
So I'd use a lower profile wire. I'd use an 18-gram Cook wire, go through the proximal cap, and use a lower profile crossing catheter, 018 typically.
Yeah, for me personally, I'd use a straight tip, high gram strength wire. The Victory wire was my friend yesterday. That might be a good one. but there's plenty. The Cook advanced CTO wire is 18 or 25 gram are quite good also. Others?
So one good thing about this patient is we can see that there is not much calcium from the CT scan and also from this fluoro. And then to me, now you're really exactly in the stent, so 0.35 GlideY, Terumol GlideY would be, hopefully it would work, and we can use the loop technique trying to get the wire down together with even this angle catheter. It would work, hopefully.
Okay. So try again with a looped Terumol using an angle catheter, all right? Any other comments, other approaches? Well, what did you end up doing?
So I appreciate all the comments. We worked pretty hard with catheter and the Ansel sheath and the Terumol wire, and it just kind of buckled. And so I checked Dr. Choi had a very good, strong cup of coffee this morning, so his right arm was strong. We then went to the dilator from the Ansel sheath. So we put the dilator in. You can see that we're about halfway into the stent at this point. So with the dilator and the Terumol wire and a good strong arm, we pushed it. Yeah, we had initially things went outside, and then if we go to the next image, I don't know that we actually captured it as we went directly through the stent or inside the stent, I should say. But we clearly got a good buckle inside, and then the Ansel advanced pretty easily at that point. So now we have the Ansel through, we have the glide wire, and we're just proceeding with the subintimal approach.
Okay, so looped subintimal. Now the challenge is reentry.
Right. So as we went down, we kind of pulled the wire back so that we could see if we could just kind of introduce the slight bend rather than the loop. And we continued to advance things down. Here you can see that image. And then we thought it was probably time to take an angio. So we took an angio at this point.
Good. See your reconstitution point. Okay, so we've done a subintimal loop, and now it's time to reenter. Panelists, what do you like to use now when it's time to re-enter? You know you're subintimal, you're trying to poke into the, you know, just beyond the distal cap to get into the true lumen. What's your technique of choice here? Assuming that re-entry devices are just not available. If you have a Pioneer, of course, makes it relatively easy. You can image it and see it, but they're on recall right now. You have an Outback LTD is another option. You have Stingrays, you have off-roads. There's a number of options to do subintimal reentry or just wire-based. Panelists? Who would use just wire-based here?
So for subintimal reentry, what I would do here first is I would take a couple angled views and get an accurate assessment of actually how far we're away from the distal cap because we may be fooled. Number two is if we're relatively close, I would switch out for a CTO wire. My typical escalation is a cool tip wire 014, 18 gram. Then I would go, just as you had said, to a polymer-coated jacket wire such as a Victory. If that wouldn't work, then I would use a 30 gram 018 wire, typically an Estato.
Estato wire, uh-huh. Others? Yep. Everyone's nodding Estato wire. Or some kind of piercing wire might be useful here. Okay, so what did you do?
So as you can see, the catheter tip is kind of directed towards that large collateral. And it appeared to me that the wire might actually be entering into that collateral branch, although you can also tell that there's kind of a compression of the lumen that appears to be happening by the catheter. So it simply brought the catheter back a little bit and then played with the wire. And it looked to me like that wire was going into the collateral. And so brought the catheter back a little bit to see if we could get down into the true lumen, and you can see there that the wire does appear to be buckling in the true lumen. Now, it's possible that we're subintimal, although it really moved pretty easily, and it did not appear to me that we were subintimal. So we went down with the catheter, and then we'll show you the next image. So at this point, we did an injection through the catheter, and you can see that we are true lumen, and we wanted to confirm that we at least had one runoff vessel to the foot. You can see that we have the dorsalis pedis filling there, and then as you continue to watch, you can see some of the plantar filling.
That's
so I thought we were good on runoff.
That's called living right. Nice job.
Dr. Choi, as I mentioned, had a good strong right arm, and I think that really helped us today. So what we're going to do now is move on. We have a wire across, and what might be your approach at this point, your selection of equipment?
Yeah, it's okay. So that was a great segue. I think I'll open this up to the panel. It's okay. Now you know you were loop subminimal all the way down, not true lumen, with reentry. What's your strategy to finish?
Well, Bob, one of the concerns I have, we noticed when we were going in that stent, the question was, did we get under the struts of that stent at that time? And that would guide sort of where I would go. So I would try to find out exactly where I am up there. If, on the other hand, I'm in the stent and then get subinimal after that, that's going to be a bit of a different strategy. But if we're subinimal along the segment, we are going to eventually have to stent.
So I think Mark indicated that they redirected, and it looked as though it was not through the side struts on the second pass. So let's assume, I think it looked as though the sheath was going, you know, through the true lumen or the center axis of the stent, not outside side struts. But we are fundamentally subintimal the whole way. The data on subintimal PTA would suggest that the primary patency of a subintimal PTA is only about two-thirds at 1 year. A lot of occlusions at the point of at the proximal and distal reentry sites. The subintimal tract itself may stay patent, but where you re-enter, you by definition have a dissection, and a lot of times that leads to occlusion. So, panelists, would you accept PTA alone and say DCB or whatever when you're doing a subintimal reentry case like this, or is this an obligatory stent situation?
Actually, I have some experience of the plain old bone angioplasty after subintimal passage of the guide wire, but its data in my hospital is not good. So currently we can use the drug-coated balloon in Korea. So usually I try to do the drug-coated balloon angioplasty after the pre-balloon dilatation, like this case.
Okay, so,
so I believe the
DCB drug-coated, and spot stenting if needed. It sounds like okay.
So balloon angioplasty followed by the DCB, and with the we may need spot stent in this patient. I think we have to minimize the length of the stent as much as possible, and if possible, just avoid stent because the patient will always come back with an instant restenosis.
Well, Mark, we're hearing some votes for a primary DCB strategy and spot stenting as needed, which is interesting to me. I think, you know, as you dilate the occlusion here, it'll be very important to do a follow-up angiogram to see if that's a viable strategy or not. We'll see if there's extensive dissection or not. If it all looks pretty good, that could be an approach. George, what do you think of that?
The other option I think on the table is if we were to stent, this would be a great place for a covered stent. A long covered stent, you'd get accurate placement. You know, we've gone into a subintimal space. The data is minimal in terms of using biologic therapies in this type of population. If I was going to do it, you know, I'm still hesitant. I think we're probably going to need a scaffold. So the question is, in my opinion, do we use several drug-eluting stents or do we use one covered stent and consider using biologic therapy on the ends?
Okay, there you have it. I mean, I think, a point very well taken for a strategy that for this Tosaka 3 occlusion and long segment total to reline this, if you will, with a Viabond endograft. It makes the distal runoff is good. This is a long segment occlusion. I think that would be a viable strategy also. Other approaches, I think it'll depend somewhat what it looks like after the ballooning. Any other approaches? Would somebody do either bare metal or drug-eluting stents for the entire occlusion? We haven't heard that yet.
I think we need to note the subintimal entry point is very close to instant restenosis portion. That is very prone to real restenosis or acute closure. So I think we cannot avoid the putting stent in any time. However, the
that is a very long segmental occlusion, so I think drug-eluting stent in whole length.
Yeah, for me personally, I have concern that the proximal stent occlusion, it seemed like it was very fibrotic and hard and difficult to cross. That would, to me, predict not a great outcome with balloon angioplasty or a high risk of recurrence at the proximal end. We'll see how it goes, but I have concerns about relying on a balloon outcome at the proximal stent occlusion.
Comments are really, really good. I appreciate some of the comments, too, about whether or not to use PTFE-covered stents in this setting. Certainly, they have some appeal. What are your thoughts about the collateral? If you recall the collateral, pretty good-sized collateral coming into the vessel about a centimeter and a half from the cap. Would you be concerned about covering that?
You know, from your wire movements, it almost looked as though you re-entered above that point, but perhaps we'll see when you do your angiogram.
DSA is fine. Yeah. So what we did is we dilated with a 5 by 200.
So fairly predictable result where the ISR segment still looks fairly narrow, but then the subinimal tract in the mid-vessel is fully dilated.
Right. So I think from what we're seeing here, we're probably going to be leaning towards the stent. We'll do another more distal injection here also under DSA. So the collateral channel still open. And we have a dissection flap that goes right down to and probably a little bit beyond that.
So I don't, you know, the teaching has always been preserve the side branches if you can, if you're going to use a covered stent. But in reality, there are other collateral side branches that can pick up for the one that's covered. So the mistake would be to come up short if you're using an endograft just to preserve that one profunda collateral, because there are others there right above the patella. So I don't think I would take that as a decision-making point. I would decide just based on the overall circumstance rather than the proximity of your reentry point to the side branch.
So I think we need to hit the stent a little bit harder. That was a 5-millimeter balloon, and we'll take a 6-4 balloon and kind of hammer that stent a little bit more and see if we can improve things up there. I think distally we're probably looking at a stent no matter what. Would everybody agree with that?
Okay, Mark, we just got word that Dr. Layard is now finished with his case and wants to show us the final results. So while you're ballooning that stent segment, we'll go over to him and then come back to you shortly.
That sounds great.
Okay. Hi, John. Welcome back.
Hey, Bob. Thanks. I just wanted to show you the final results. You know, we went ahead and did a prolonged inflation in that distal stent area with a 5-millimeter balloon and ended up with a nice result. You can see just very minor dissection outside the stent and then beyond it in the popliteal artery. Typical DCB result. I think I'm very happy with that. We don't need to stent. We show the next run, Dr. Lee. And we just checked our distal below knee vessels to make sure there's no evidence of any problem or embolization down there. Okay. Everything's fine. And then next shot. Then just another look at the entire length of the stent. I think it looks good, Bob. You know, it's a typical kind of approach, you know, with DCB, pre-dilate, you know, do long inflations with DCB. In this case, 3-minute inflation with a 5 balloon, then a 3-minute inflation with a 6 balloon. And then if you don't get a perfect result, you can go back and do even longer inflations, which we did, and got a beautiful angiographic result. And in this case, avoided a stent in the popliteal artery, which I think is desirable. So I think this is the kind, if you're going to use DCB, you want to commit to it, and you want to do long inflations and commit to a good angiographic result and try and avoid additional metal.
So, John, when you went back and did a prolonged inflation, was that with the Admiral DCB balloon, or did you pick another one?
Yeah, we actually just went back with the Admiral 5-millimeter and did a 5-minute inflation. So okay. I don't think there's any harm in using that balloon again. And
sure.
Maybe some slight incremental benefit.
Sure. Okay. Very nice result.
Yeah, very good.
All right. Well, thanks. We'll send it back over to Mark, and thanks to everyone here in Lab 5.
Nice job. Great. Okay, we'll go back to Mark's
lab. Thank you.
Okay, Mark, we're back to you.
Okay, so we put in a 6x4 balloon into the into the stented segment, we have it up at 20 atmospheres. You can see here that there is full expansion in the proximal stent. There's still a little bit of kind of a filling defect in the distal stent, indicating that there's some smooth muscle in there that's kind of obstructing things. We're going to give this a little bit of time to kind of remodel, and then we'll take another angio and come up with an end game strategy. For the distal, we're thinking probably Zilver PTX. Let's do a replay on the more proximal vessel once again.
So as he's working on this for the panelists,
let's back
this is fairly typical in that a lot of times you have difficulty dilating
let's
the
just leave
proximal
that
inlet
in,
and
we'll
the
see if we can do any outlet while that's in.
Segments of the subinimal tract, and that the remainder of the subinimal tract in the mid-vessel dilates well and looks pretty good. So if you're looking at stenting, the inflow and outflow reentry points, do you stent the entire column or leave the subinimal tract alone?
Actually, my strategy is just to leave alone in between the proximal and distal entry. So just a balloon angioplasty is enough in this subinimal tract navigation. And then I need a stent or something in the proximal and distal entry site. After the balloon response, so in this patient, this patient has a stent in the proximal entry site. I think some cutting balloon or debulking device is needed at the proximal site, and then DCB is enough. And distal, I think the bigger balloon and long inflation will be enough.
Okay, so since it's a stented segment, debulk that and do a DCB, something like that. Don't necessarily need another stent. Distal end is problematic, huh? You have dissection and so forth. So for the mid segment, would you just do POBA, PTA or DCB?
Just PTA.
Just PTA, okay. Other comments? A lot of us have done quite a few of these and seen the outcomes long term. Is PTA good enough in the mid segment subinimal tract in these cases? Does it hold up? Or do you run into problems leaving it alone?
I normally would always want a stent above and below the dissection plane, so I would not feel comfortable about a DCB in it. I like the idea of the Zilver PTX. I mean, we have. People talk about all these different technologies. The only thing that, with good five-year results, the Zilver PTX looks very well. So it works very well. So that's a thought, since we're going to have to stent anyway.
Seems like most of the panelists are nodding in agreement with doing a drug-eluting stent distally for the dissected segment. Some debate on what to do with the remainder, proximal and distal. There's some votes for just doing a DCB at the top, since it's an instant problem, and whether you can debulk it or not is a matter of what's available to you. But the remainder of the subinimal tract in the mid vessel that looks pretty good is the one thing that we're debating what to do with. Just there's some votes for just PTA. There's other votes for doing a DCB. Haven't heard many votes for doing a stent the entire column, but perhaps that's an option too. Comments? I've done a lot of these, and when I stent just proximal and distal, a lot of times the patients come back with problems in the middle.
Yeah.
In the subinimal tract, if you leave it alone, might only take 6 months or more, but you tend to run into issues. So I think if I'm going to treat it with balloon alone, it might be DCB. This is sort of a new territory for us. It's not well studied. But POBA alone, I do know in my own personal experience, I tend to see late problems in the non-stented segments in the middle. Other comments?
Dr. Park and I were just discussing, especially in Korea, they would typically use a stent, distal stent proximal, and then a drug-coated balloon in the middle. But I think you raise a great question, Bob, in the sense that should you just line the entire segment? Because I also see the same. If you're going to have restenosis, typically it's in that mid-segment.
Yeah, I think a Viabond strategy is a very good one here, a very appropriate strategy here. You have good runoff, and it's a Tosaka 3 at the top and a long segment total in a large vessel that has good runoff. So I think that approach would be quite well supported. Would be a good support, good approach.
Well, actually, we can do.
Anyway, they're going the route of a drug eluting stent in this case, which is perfectly reasonable. So tell us, Mark, what stent do you have, and what's your strategy?
So we have a 6x100 Zilver PTX, and we're going to deploy that. I think the dissection goes just distal to that little collateral, to that good size collateral, I should say. So I'm thinking try to drop the distal end right around 10, and that should get the worst of the dissection, which is in the 12 to 15 range, and we'll get a little benefit then more proximally.
And some of that, quote, dissection looks like thrombus, perhaps.
Yeah,
it's good
right.
to trap it before you balloon anymore.
Let's just go to regular fluoro. So we have a stored image here, and we're going to try to drop the distal end of the Zilver PTX right at 10. This is the push-pull system. If you've had the privilege of doing the thumb wheel for the Zilver PTX, I think that's really a step in the right direction.
It has really greatly improved the accuracy of the deployment and also eliminated the issue of bunching or foreshortening or elongation, which can always happen when you have a push-pull system.
So what I do with these is I get it to flower a little bit distally. I found especially with this delivery, it's kind of sticky. And so I want it to flower. Then I bring it back to where I want. Mm-hmm. And then I just keep it really solidly fixed. Looks like I can pull it back even a hair more.
The audience needs to watch how slowly he's doing this and carefully he's doing this so he has complete control. And Mark has deployed thousands of these. So even with his experience, you see how slowly he does this. This is not something that you quickly do it. You want to be accurate.
You know, I think one of the things that I really emphasize in the cath lab, we always say that a slow procedure is a dangerous procedure. But there's a time to be slow, and that's, I think, with stent deployment, as you said. This is not the time to rush. So now, after I've got it well anchored, what I do is I forget about the distal part, and I'm just looking now towards the proximal end. You can see that marker is around 18 or so. So I just kind of keep my eye on the 18, and I try to keep that in a fixed position, and that way it's not going to either elongate or compress. Again, with the thumb wheel, that's eliminated a lot of this.
Yeah, so the newer generation that replaces this, you won't have to worry about it anymore, but there's still a number of stents on the shelf where you still have to do the push-pull technique. And what you want to try to consciously avoid is compressing the stent by moving both hands toward each other. You want to fix and pin, if you will, one, six. And then retract.
Let's use a six long.
Either left to right or right to left,
like
depending on how you're operating.
150. So I think what we'll do now is we're going to, now that we have the stent deployed, it's well expanded but not fully expanded. Position looks good to me. We'll now use a long six bare balloon, and we'll use that to kind of tack up the stent, treat a little bit more proximally. And then I think we'll come up with a decision for the more proximal vessel. But the way I'm leaning is probably a long DEB that extends through the stented area and then as far distally as we can get it.
So how does the stent occlusion segment look now that you've dilated it further? Have we seen the result of that? Can you show us an angiogram?
Yeah. Can we go back to that last angiogram of the... We left the balloon in the ansel when we took the shot, so we didn't have full opacification, and a lot of the flow went down the profunda, but here you can see it's at least improved.
Better. Definitely better.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And it's to the point where I think with maybe a little bit of extra help with some more balloon inflation, it's enough that we can leave it with the benefit of a DEB, and I don't think we're being overly optimistic to think that it may stay open.
So I'm not personally aware of any data on cementimal applications of DCBs. Is anyone else? That's something that I think it would be useful to collect data on, have a registry on, in patients who have deliberate loop technique and so forth. So this is a 6 millimeter diameter?
Yeah, this is a six millimeter balloon. You notice that we deliberately didn't extend it down beyond the end of the stent. Really would rather not have a distal edge dissection. And it looks like we're getting good expansion. So Dr. Choi and I were discussing, and the patient's feeling that, so that tells me that we've got adequate adventitial size here. So Dr. Choi and I were talking about if we did stent this, what would be the various stent strategies, and there was some discussion about a supera. One of the things, though, that we've been impressed by is the lack of calcification, as one of the panelists pointed out. So I think we kind of have the option of going with a conventional nitinol tube stent.
I would agree with that. Typically, you know, as you saw, your subinimal tract dilated well, so you don't need a super high radial force device for this. And typically, when you're subinimal, you're going around the calcium rather than through it. And this lesion does not appear to be heavily calcified. So I don't think you need a supera for that purpose. Whether to leave it alone or just do a long DCB is the question. Because it looks pretty good.
With regard to the calcium, even here in the lab where we're looking right at the image, I can't see any calcium, not even in the adductor canal. So that's we've been unusually fortunate in that regard.
And it's a good prognostic sign.
So we'll go ahead and come down, and then we'll move the balloon more proximally. Our proximal end right now is about 22, so we'll kind of move it up the leg. And let's keep 22 in the field of view, and we'll have Dr. Choi bring that back.
Well, so now how are the panelists feeling about finishing this with a DCB at the top and maybe a long DCB down in there and call it a day?
22.
Mm-hmm. Feeling better about it at this point, or still have some reservations?
Yeah, I think it's definitely an option, Bob. The other thing I worry about is not the restenotic pattern; it's just that recoil in the center over time. But I think it's a great option. Stent the distal and then see how it looks, and if we can get away with a drug-coated balloon to do it, and then always have the option of coming back and stenting the entire segment if we have to.
It'll be interesting to see how the stent occlusion segment looks after this balloon angioplasty, because it appears as though it's recoiling to a certain degree and that it's a hard fibrotic lesion. If it continues to recoil, then I have concern about DCB alone, because the drug will be effective, but the recoiling tissue will still be there.
So we'll do an angioplasty.
It'll be interesting to see how this looks.
So I think one of the things that has really been helpful from the drug-coated balloon trials is we really haven't pushed angioplasty the way that we should have over the last decade or so. And as hard as it is to sit here and not do anything while the balloon's up, I think sometimes if we have the patience to leave the balloon inflated, we're going to get a better result than we would otherwise.
Well, we had at least two comments about using a scoring or focal balloon technology for this ISR segment, which may make some sense in the absence of atherectomy. And I'm not sure if you have that available to you, but if it's still recoiling, it might be useful.
So actually Dr. Choi and I were having that very discussion as we were kind of waiting to go live here, and we do not have an angio score here in the lab, but we do have a cutting balloon, depending on the size of cutting balloon that we selected, we may actually have to upsize our sheath. So we thought if we can get by without going with a scoring balloon, we would. And part of our thought process, too, was that although cutting balloons certainly give a nice angiographic appearance, we're kind of short on data that would indicate there's a better prognosis. Now, they certainly may increase the ability. We'll go ahead and put in the Luton. We'll do the shot here. We're going to do a shot and see how we're looking after that six.
Now, Mark, that looks better. There was one interesting study in the coronary arena using angioscore prior to DCB for coronary ISR, where the angioscore facilitated the DCB outcome and had less late loss in follow-up. Made some sense to us, but it was interesting to me that just doing a scoring balloon facilitated drug transfer and effectiveness. So that's in the coronary literature, not in the endo. So, it could be of benefit to you if you had it available. Cutting balloon by inference, you would suggest, might yield the same outcome. But this is looking okay. Panelists, are you satisfied with that? Do we need to do more?
It looks like we need a stent probably proximal to the prior stent, probably a 40 millimeter or so, at least to tack that, that significant dissection.
Okay, George is voting for a stent up there. And there's also this filling defect in the middle at the lower end of the screen, which I'm not sure if that represents thrombus or if that's dissection. Looks too round.
Yeah, I think George has hit it right on, that if we leave that alone, we're probably going to have a great result distally, great result proximally, and we may lose the whole show in the middle portion.
Other than that, it's fine.
So I'm checking. Have we already opened the drug-coated balloon?
Yes. Sure.
Okay. So we have a 10-centimeter drug-coated balloon, and that may impact what we decide as far as a length for our stent. So we're going to need to use drug-coated balloon from about 34 down to about 24, somewhere around there. And then we'll try. I think what we can do is, we can use a drug-coated balloon first. We'll see where the distal marker lies, and then we will make a decision about the most appropriate drug-coated stent to bridge the gap. What do you guys think about that?
Well, that's one strategy. We had a vote just to extend with another drug-eluting stent to cover the entire problem. But, you know, there's really a lot of ways to skin the cat. My concern is this distal filling defect looks like an old organized thrombus rather than dissection, and with ballooning it may embolize. So I'm almost more inclined to trap rather than balloon in this case.
So just so candidly, one of the things that has influenced our decision is that we had already opened the 6x100 balloon. And so we thought that die was kind of cast, and so we'll go ahead and inflate the DEB right here.
Okay.
So, Mark, what anticoagulant strategy are you using currently for this patient?
This is heparin, and the patient got an initial bolus. We checked an ACT. It was 220, so we gave some additional heparin. And if we take much longer here, we'll go ahead and recheck another ACT. So we're going to leave this up here for a while, and you can see that when we cover the proximal end of the stent, that brings us down to about 27, and the edge of the screen is right about 20, so we're going to need every bit of 8 centimeters, and if we account for a little bit of overlap, we might just go with another 6'10". What do you guys think about that?
I think at least that long. So this case brings up a lot of topics. It's a great case. One of the things it brings up is embolic protection. When dealing with these long segment occlusions, the panelists, do you routinely apply embolic protection? Do you use it at all? Do you not use it? What do? Not normally. Not routinely at all. Yeah. Others?
So if I use some debulking device, I use a distal filter device.
DB?
In this case, so subintimal tracking, I didn't need
If it's subintimal, don't feel it's necessary, but if you're debulking, yes. Okay. Others?
If there's three vessel runoff, if there's one vessel runoff, I'm leaning more towards using it no matter what the anatomy.
And I would lean as well toward it. Now the question is what type of embolic protection would you use? And typically I use a NAV6. For this, it would be a large NAV6 at the level of the popliteal. Remember, when you do this, that you're going to need to switch out your wires. So typically what I'll do is once I cross the lesion, then I'll switch out. Typically the wire you'll use is a Viper wire. It's an 014, 017 tip, and the new Viper Flex is an 018 tip. But that'll hold the large NAV6 on the end of the wire. Remember to do that. There's another wire that's a Viper's 014014. If you were to use that, you would lose the NAV6 off the end of your wire. The nice thing about the NAV6 is it's a free floating filter such that you can remove the filter with never losing your wire placement, which I think in these long chronic total occlusions is very important.
Okay, we have a question from the audience.
I'm Mark. I'm Dr. Chong Chu from Taiwan. I want to ask, since we have a very long SFA lesion, maybe 30 or 35 centimeters, so how about another approach, maybe just dilate and deliver heparin coating via bound graft stent V3H because it's very long lesion. See, we know that drug into dry eluting technology is also very good, but our data is not so long, 30 or 40 centimeters, and via bound they have very long lesion data. And I know also that heparin coating via bound has been study in Japan and also have good results. So what's your point? And another is we have 25 centimeter via bound, so if you deliver you deal with the lesion via bound, you don't have to put so many stents, and procedure time will be so will be shortened a lot.
Sure, another vote here for a Viabon approach. You know, it's a 35 centimeter occlusion, good large vessel, good runoff, ISR, Tosaka 3, on and on. And the point was made that it would shorten the procedure to do one 25 centimeter plus maybe a 10 or 15. Point very well taken, and we mentioned a couple times that would be a very very reasonable and viable approach to this as well. It's not what the operators are doing, but that would be, I think, supported by many.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I think you could make a good case for that. Again, we did have that issue of the large collateral coming in distally that we wanted to protect, but I think we could avoid it, or I guess if we covered it, we could hope for the best, although I still would rather have it open. It also leaves us with a little bit of material inside the proximal stented area, and if we can get by with a DEB, I think I'd prefer that. But I think you could make a case for covered. Now, looking at things financially in the United States, the DEB is going to get reimbursed dollar for dollar, and the stents are going to come right out of the hospital budget, and that would include either a Zilver PTX or a Viabon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, although in this case, I think cost-wise, you know, you already have one DES and a DEB, and I'm not sure what else is going into this case, and the two Viabonds may not be more than the sum total of all the hardware that's being used in this long occlusion. So I think points well taken. I think you have two excellent strategies. You could either go drug-coated balloon and stent route, or you can go reline route. I think both are very... I think, acceptable approaches to this, either one.
So this is just about the perfect length. The distal end of the balloon was at 27, and so you can see that we are going to have just about the right amount of overlap, in my opinion. You guys agree with that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So again, we're going to kind of take our time here with the initial deploy. We've had some of the Zilver PTXs where it takes all the strength you have just to kind of break that seal.
To get
initially.
Started.
Yeah.
So this is a 6 by 80 or what do you have?
This is a 6 by 100.
100. Okay.
Yeah. So I like that position right there. We're going to have a little bit of overlap distally, and we're going to have a little bit of overlap proximally. And I like the fact that we're getting full expansion here. I think we'll hit this with a 6-millimeter bare balloon afterwards, but I like how that deployed, and it seems to have fully expanded. Dr. Choi is very busy, and it's wonderful to have somebody who keeps that wire dead on through the whole procedure.
So now you'll post-dilate with a 6-balloon.
Right. So we've already post-dilated the distal stent. We'll post-dilate the proximal stent. We've already used the DEB proximally, and then we'll see if we have an acceptable result. You're stating that maybe we'd have to use something else. I hope that this is all the expense we've run into on this case.
Right. So far we have two DCBs, or one DCB and two DESs this case, plus a couple of other HOBA balloons.
So we've got about $5,000 in drug-eluting equipment here in this case so far.
Well, your timing's perfect. We have about 9 minutes left, so we'll do the PTA of the Zilver that was just put in, and then hopefully we'll have a nice angiogram for completion here. So as he's working away, what are we going to accept up top as far as an outcome? Rich?
Well, I must admit, I don't think it looks too bad up on top right now, but let's see what it looks like in relationship to the rest of the vessel if there's been recoil. I agree with the thoughts that I would have used a focus balloon. We don't have that available quite the way I would want it. The cutting balloon, I'm sure it performs well, but I think some of the more modern focus balloons, I think, work a little bit better, but there's no data. So I think we'll see what it looks like.
So hopefully we'll be pleasantly surprised, but if there's recoil, we have seen recoil during this case more than once with the balloons. So
yeah.
Do we walk away from a 30% or a 40% or a 50%? Or let's assume there's no dissection. We haven't seen any yet. Do we just walk away regardless? Or at what point do we say we need something else?
I would say if there was a flow-limiting dissection for sure or recoil that look would jeopardize the work that we've done distally, then I would consider.
Anyone else? 50% or greater, walk, then treat? Dissection, of course. Flow-limiting dissection, no issue. Let's see how it looks. Hopefully it's a small residual.
Bob, for that short dissection,
we'll do a non-subtracted run here and just follow it down the leg. We'll see what we got.
We just put the stent in. Would you ever consider putting a tack in there? You know, Peter Snyder's TOBA, the tack, just a tack, but it's in a subentimal plane.
If it's strictly a dissection flap, yes. In this lesion, since it's hard and recoiling, the tack has really low radial strength. So, yes, as predicted, you can see good stent expansions, but the ISR lesion tends to be recoiling to a certain degree, moderate degree. Okay, panelists, what do? Are we done? Anything else to do in this case? Let's go down the line from the end on up. Dr. Lita, we haven't heard from you much. Let's, how about, what do you think?
Let's subtract below the knee.
Is this acceptable? Would you do any more? Are you satisfied?
I think acceptable results. So I'm very happy to
Jamal.
We found that good collateral just deploy the Ziba PTX for this part of the safety. If we deploy the covered stent for this
part of
the safety, we sacrifice the big collateral from the profound artery. So we just looked at the good collateral. The congratulations for nice.
So it's a little hard to hear, but are you happy or would you do more?
I think that this result is acceptable.
Acceptable result. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
So you would walk at this point. All right. Others?
What about the non-compliant balloon angioplasty?
Non-compliant balloon angioplasty. So you would do more. You would do more.
One more thing about the proximal stent. To me, it's a little bit relatively small. Is it possible that we can apply relatively bigger DCB with a higher pressure, trying to open it up a little bit more, and also trying to get rid of some recoil, if possible?
All right, we have a couple votes so far for doing more up at the top to eliminate the recoil.
This part of SFA is acceptable, but I want to direct more than the proximal stent using focal force angioplasty.
Using what again? I'm sorry.
Using focal force angioplasty. I want to direct more in the proximal segment of stent.
All right, do more. George?
Yeah, I think I would leave it alone.
It's
about a 30% residual. The one thing that keeps catching my eyes, we have one vessel runoff. And why did it close to begin with? Is it because we didn't have enough runoff? You know, Galeno and Davies have shown us eloquently that the more runoff you have, so if you have two or more vessels, your patency for your SFA intervention is about 70%. For one or less vessels, it's about 30% at a two-year period. So the question is, there's a short TP trunk occlusion, it looks like the perineal fields, should we focus on that? I'm just throwing it out there. I'm not saying we should. especially in a clotted kit, but it may help us in terms of patency.
Although we don't have the benefit of the pre-intervention angiogram before to know how much of the disease was really there and how much was treated and how much wasn't. It could have been just a downstream lesion led to the problem. Rich?
Yeah, I think with what equipment we have at hand, I probably would quit. I'm afraid I make matters worse.
So there you go, about a 50-50 on whether to leave it alone or do more. So what's your feeling there?
Well, we've been looking for a coin so that we could flip to make the decision here. And we didn't find a coin, but I think Dr. Troy and I are unanimous that we're happy with where it is right now. Yeah, it'd be great to have a 0% residual, but we do have a drug coating effect there within the short segment that was reoccluded. I like what we're seeing in the DEB and DES regions, and we still have patent runoff, so I think it's quitting time.
Okay. Nobody mentioned just doing a pressure gradient. You know, that can be useful at times to, you know, if you have no gradient, it's a bit reassuring. If you have a gradient, I think that would speak to doing more. But it looks pretty good. I myself, sometimes, and when it's on the fence, I'll just do a pressure gradient to get some reassurance that I don't need to do more. But it looks pretty good. I think the panelists are all fine with that, and that was an excellent job. Wanted to congratulate you on showing great technique on loop wire. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, with that, that concludes our first session, and we'll go to a break, returning at 10 a.m. Great. In a few minutes.
Great job. Good to see you, Dan.
That's okay.
Robert, good to see you. Great.